How do you go from this to this? Well, studio interference and the poor critical reception of Batman v Superman certainly steered the ship in a certain direction that DC are now seemingly trying to correct with the release of Zack Snyder's Justice League. David Ayer's Suicide Squad was certainly a victim of this, and the theatrical cut that we got is actually a far cry from the original version. Throughout this video, we're going to be breaking down the main differences in the movie, how its ending tied into Justice League, and most of the major character changes that were made to the film in order to release it. Whether this is your first time at the channel or you're a regular, welcome to the Heavy Spoilers Show. I'm your host Paul, aka the Hunker Hunker who don't want no beef like a vegetarian. Now let's get into the breakdown. Okay, so the first trailer that we got for Suicide Squad was tonally completely different to what we got in the theatrical cut. I can't play the entire thing because of copyright reasons, but if you haven't seen it, then I definitely recommend that you go back and watch it after this video, for just a sense of the atmosphere that Ayer was going for. It's haunting, very dim and dark, and honestly feels like one of the best comic book movie trailers ever made. Clearly, the director was going for a much more grounded and gritty tone than what we got in the theatrical cut, which switched from Eminem's Without Me to Bohemian Rhapsody faster than Ezra chokes out a fan when they ask to fight him. It's completely all over the place, whereas the original, according to Ayer, was meant to be more somber, with the aim being to leave people completely shell-shocked. The movie was not meant to be a comedy, but it was transformed to feel more like Deadpool, even though the jokes and character moments weren't really meant for that. The original trailer itself opens with an ethereal version of the song I Started a Joke, and similar to the music itself, the film was meant to be laced with irony. These are criminals and prisoners that are being used to fight and die for a country that hates them, and instead, what we got was a bunch of clowns with a certain set of skills that were more gimmicky than fully fleshed out characters. This would of course also carry across to the villain of the piece, aka Enchantress. Though the complex relationship between her and Rick Flagg is hinted at in the movie, we never really get to learn why he loves June, and pretty much their entire relationship and her backstory is completely glossed over. In the original version of the film, we will get to see archaeologist June discovering the tomb of Enchantress and see the agony that it caused her being possessed by a wicked and evil immortal sorceress. The film would deal with the dichotomy of her character and how Amanda Waller was happy sacrificing her sanity in order to further her own goals. Waller is another character who too would receive far more development, and we would really get the idea that she was an evil entity that manipulated people into doing her bidding. If you walked up to someone on the streets who didn't know anything about the comic books and described a person who basically puts bombs in people's necks and gets them to do whatever she wants, then they'd probably imagine a villain like Jigsaw or worse. Waller is meant to be as bad as the criminals that she controls, but because of her powers and position in government, she is allowed to operate without any consequences and can kill people without question just because they say no to her. She really is a wicked woman, but this entire point of her character feels completely missing from the main movie. Even when she guns down her own staff, there's a joke right after it to alleviate the tension, and when jokes are thrown towards someone like this, then they themselves just become a joke. Now the idea of her basically being as bad as everyone else would be hammered home in the Ayer cut, and juxtaposing this, the more sympathetic plea of June would be played up. Here is a woman that's ordering a man to go and murder the woman he loves, but this is never really discussed in the film. Now because of Flagg's relationship with June being far more fleshed out, the ending in which he decides to kill her feels that much more impactful. We truly get the idea that he was willing to sacrifice his humanity in order to do his duty, and it paints him out as a man who puts the greater good above his own wishes. This darkness was also carried over to the character designs, and rather than making each one of them look fun and approachable, things had a much more darker side to them. This was especially shown in Enchantress, who was much more like a siren or spirit that was haunting to look at. When criticized about the look being over-sexualized, Ayer shared some concept art in which we could see a golden goddess with thousands of eyes adorned all over her. These eyes were of course present in her drones, and they become much more apparent in her design, making it so that the two were far more similar. Now if you're enjoying the video so far, then I'd massively appreciate it if this was the moment that you hit the thumbs up button. The more attention that we can get towards this movie, the more likely it is that it'll be released, and if you want to see it, then you have to let the studio know. Anyway, As for the side characters, everyone's favourite rope-themed villain Slipknot got a couple more beats, and we actually saw how he was caught and what he was doing at the time. Though neither Ayer or the actor playing him, Adam Beach, have elaborated on this, we would have loved to have seen him hanging around in the film a lot more. Hanging joke with a rope there now. Katana 2 received a bigger focus, and in the theatrical version, she was cut from having any real character development. Karen Fukuhara stated that Katana was much more of a threat to the squad itself, and at one point she was possessed by Enchantress, who then used her to fight them. Batman 2 had a couple of extra moments, and these portrayed how he worked and operated in Gotham as a nighttime vigilante. In an interview with Lady Falcon, Richard Cetrone, aka Ben Affleck's stunt double, discussed some of the extra things that he was doing. During the interview, he stated that there were a couple of tidbits here and there that didn't make the final edit, and that Batman had some cool little moments that diehard Dark Knight fans would have absolutely loved. Because of the behind-the-scenes images, we know that Batman was trying to get into the car by cutting it open with a torch, but this too was sadly removed. He was of course after the Joker, and I don't think that it's news to anyone that Jared Leto had many of his scenes cut completely. Leto has been very vocal about all the work that he did for the film, which didn't make it through to the edit that was shown in cinemas. Though teased at in the theatrical and extended cut, the film took a much larger focus on the abusive relationship between him and Harley. There were many more nods to Mad Love, and we saw she was more of a weapon to Joker that he uses an extension of himself in order to cause havoc in Gotham. Harley was supposed to truly see that she didn't need him, and by the end of the film she would gain her independence rather than simply falling back into his arms. In the film, he apparently threw her out of the helicopter because he was jealous of not only her new friends, but also her relationship with Deadshot. The pair have had several romances in the comic books, and there was meant to be much more of a love triangle between her, the Joker, and of course him, the best shot in the world. Now, the wickedness of the Joker was seen in almost all aspects of his portrayal, and during his conversation with Monster T, instead of shooting him, he actually convinced him to take his own life. The Clown Prince of Crime is of course a complex character that simply doesn't go around just shooting people, but instead he crafts intricate games for them to play, and this would be much more harrowing for viewers who would get to see his darker side rather than him being just some run-of-the-mill gangster. He played a much bigger role, and after the helicopter crash, the character showed up at the climax of the movie with a badly burned face and hand grenade. Because of his jealousy, he wanted to kill the entire squad, and even pulled out the pin of the explosive at one point in order to intimidate them. In the finale, he made a deal with Enchantress, and the pair took Amanda Waller hostage. In exchange for helping her, the Enchantress agreed that she'd make him King of Gotham and would give him Harley as his slave. Thus, the finale would see Harley having to fight the man she loves, Flag having to fight the woman that he does, and because of this, the stakes would be much higher. Now, the ending also changed the fate of one of its key characters, and in the finale, El Diablo survived the last encounter. Instead of sacrificing himself, he made it through until the end, and it was likely planned that he would be in the sequel for the movie. El Diablo, in my opinion, is one of the best characters in the film, and his self-sacrifice in calling people that he'd known for 5 minutes his family was a bit of a weird turn, which of course would be rectified in this change. Now, as we mentioned earlier, the movie was meant to tie into Justice League directly, and Incubus was replaced by a Parademon. This was sent to Earth by either Steppenwolf or Darkseid to scope out the planet in order to see whether the invasion could commence in the following film. Obviously, it left a lot of questions up in the air towards the bigger threat that was coming down the line, and it just left the audience asking more questions. Now, this is also why Bruce would meet Waller in the end, and then go off to form the Justice League so that he could fight these forces. Overall, the film sounded like a much better way to display Task Force X on the big screen, and it is really a shame that this is what we could have got. Now, whilst we still don't know whether the original outline will ever see the light of day, the Snyder Cut has shown us that you can have whatever you want, you just have to wish for it. If it does ever come out, then this will be the third version of Suicide Squad, including the theatrical cut, the extended edition, and now the Ayer one. New clips are surfacing online constantly, and hopefully the success of Zack Snyder's Justice League will usher this in to be the next film released. As we know, Justice League will have a new scene featuring Leto, and a lot more, so it would be amazing if they could set things up in order to build the Snyderverse. Either way, these are the major differences between the main cut and the one that we could have got. Obviously, I'd love to hear your thoughts on the information below and whether you want to see the Snyderverse restored or not. But don't forget that on the 30th of January, we're giving away 3 copies of The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings 4K box sets to our subscribers. All you have to do to be in with a chance of winning is like the video, make sure you subscribe with notifications on, and drop a comment below with your thoughts on the breakdown. If you want something else to watch, then make sure you check out our breakdown of the first 2 episodes of WandaVision, which will be linked on screen right now. We go over all the ins and outs and Easter eggs in the entry, so it's definitely worth checking out if you want something else to do, because let's face it, it's very boring this time of year. Anyway, if not, thanks for sitting until the end of the video. You've been Paul, I'll see you next time. Take care, peace.